Hello students, in the last class we have been discussed about exempted incomes under section 10. Out of that we discussed section 10 subsection 10b, that is related to retrenchment compensation. We already discussed about what do you mean by retrenchment, what do you mean by retrenchment compensation, how much is eligible to receive in the hands of the employee, what is the provisions in connection with the Industrial Dispute Act 1947. So we discussed it is equal to 15 days average salary. So out of that we are having three category. One is monthly salary employee, second one weekly salary employee, third one daily wages. We already discussed about what about in case of monthly salary employee, that is last 3 months average pay. Second one, in case of workers or laborers. Usually in the case of the workers and labor, they are getting the salary on the basis of week. If you are having the information on the basis of week, we have to going to consider the average pay is equal to average of last 4 completed weeks. Average of last 4 completed weeks. Say for example, if he is retrenched in the month of January, in the January end if he is retrenched, so in the January month he is having, there is 4 weeks, and if he is receiving salary from each week and he is having the 4 week salary, we have to take average 4 weeks salary. For example, first week he may have 2000 rupees, second week 3000 rupees, fourth week 4000 rupees, third week 3000 rupees, fourth week 4000 rupees. So we have to get aggregate of all these 4 weeks, should be divided by 4. Then we will get average 4 week salary. Then we have to convert it into 1 day salary, that has to be multiplied by 15. That is second category, if he is a labor and workers. So that is compensation as per the Industrial Dispute Act 1947. Now come to the third category. Third category in the case of daily wages. In case of the daily wages, the person is working and daily wages, and if an employer retrenched that particular employee, and how much is eligible to receive? The amount of average pay is equal to, so wages of lost full 12 working days. Lost full 12 working days. So he may receive the same amount in all 12 days, he may not receive same amount, he may receive different amount. One day one salary, another day one salary, either it may be reduced or increased. But while calculating the amount of compensation as per Industrial Dispute Act, we have to take to consider 12 days aggregate salary, full working day. Last 12 full working days aggregate salary. Say for example, first we have to take all 12 days salary, that should be divided by 12 and you will get 1 day salary. That should be multiplied by 15 days. That is the amount of compensation. Students, now we already discussed about what is the amount which is eligible in the hands of different kinds of employee, like salary employee, that is monthly salary employee, weekly salary employee, and daily wages employee. So this is amount which is eligible as per the Industrial Dispute Act 1947. I told you in the beginning, 15 days salary. Then what do you mean by salary? As we all know, for exemption purpose, as per Income Tax Act 1961, salary is different for different purpose. For example, HRA purpose, salary is different. Gratuity purpose, salary is different. Leave encashment purpose, salary is different. Commutation of pension, salary is different, like that. In case of retrenchment compensation also, salary is different. Then what do you mean by salary? What salary should include, what salary should not include? Here we are categorizing the so many emoluments as included and excluded. First we have to look into what salary should include. Anyhow, basic plus DA, so value of accommodation, the rent free accommodation, water benefit, that is in the name of perquisites, medical benefits in the name of perquisites, and late travel concession. These kind of emoluments should be included as a salary while calculating 15 days salary. I repeat. Anyhow, as usual, basic plus DA and any other taxable perquisites like rent free accommodation, leave travel allowances, medical benefits, that should be included. But some emoluments should not included, that should be excluded. Then what all the amount should be excluded? Bonus should not be included in the salary for this purpose. Employer's contribution to pension fund should not be included. Provident fund gratuity amount should not be included, because while at the time of retrenchment, he may receive some retirement benefit like gratuity, pension and contribution of employer to the provident fund. So these amounts should not be included. I repeat, gratuity amount should not be included. Employer contribution to the pension fund should not be included. Bonus should not be included. So remaining these, the amount is considered as salary and we have to take 15 days salary. That is the meaning of salary. I told in the beginning that should be exempted to the extent of three things. One is actual, second one is 5 lakh rupees and third one is as per the provision, and such exceptions are there. The main exception in case of leave travel, sorry, retrenchment compensation exemption is where the compensation is paid under the scheme approved by the central government is exempt from tax. There is no these kind of provisions. For example, if an employee is receiving compensation by the any employer on the basis of certain schemes which is prescribed by the central government, the entire amount is exempted. There is no tax liability on retrenchment compensation. For example, if an employee receiving 10 lakh rupees as a compensation from the employer on the basis of certain schemes which is prescribed by central government, the entire amount is exempted. There is no tax liability. Other than this scheme, if an employer give the compensation to the employee at the time of retrenchment, that is exempted as per section 10, subsection 10b, as we discussed in the previous slide about how the different stages are there, what do you mean by salary, that has to be taken to consider. So this is about retrenchment compensation. So today we have discussed about the retrenchment compensation and its tax liability. It's very simple. While calculating the total income of an employee under the head income from salary, sometimes if he is retrenched from the employer, we have to take into consider the retrenchment compensation is a salary. So for that purpose, we have to concentrate on what do you mean by retrenchment. Every time it is not considered as a retrenchment because there is a break of contract between the employer and employee. So sometimes if he is voluntarily retired, it is not called as retrenchment. Because of lockout, if he is not receiving any salary and giving some amount, it is not retrenchment. Retrenchment is nothing but cancellation of contract between the employer and employee. That should be considered. Second one, retrenchment compensation. Under which scheme he is receiving compensation? As regularly he is receiving compensation or as per the central government scheme. And the third one is we have to take into consider what kind of employee he is. Whether he is monthly employee, monthly wages employee, salary employee, weekly salary employee or daily wages employee. Then we have to take into consider 15 days salary. While calculating 15 days, we have to concentrate these three because average pay has to be taken. Average pay is different for monthly employee, monthly salary employee, weekly salary employee and daily wages employee. After that, we have to take into consider which is the least amount. That least amount is eligible as exemption in section 10, subsection 10b from the actual amount of compensation, and remaining amount is called as taxable compensation. So this is about retrenchment compensation. We can calculate so many problems on the basis of information given by the employer or employee as illustration. Thank you.